Shalom, greetings to all and all. Selamta, t'ina istilin. This is Ras Alonso Tafar reporting for the Lion of the Tribe of Judah Society of His Imperial Majesty, Haile Selassie I, and His Christ Jesus, HaMashiach, Yeshua. For the record, this day is Sunday, May 28th, and 2017, and it is 11:35 a.m. Now the following work that we are to present, we do or we bring forth on the basis that to do what we can is to do what we must. If ones can perform it better, then by all means, feel free to do so. Now, a few key points, disclaimers, not really, but you know, something of that nature. The following text that we are to read, we must make mention that the names in Amharic, the Amharic names, the pronunciation of them cannot be assured that we will do it as accurately as it would have been possible if the names would have been provided for in the Amharic text or in the Amharic language. That is, we do not know the vowel system, the pointing on the vowel system that is utilized, which includes the English alphabet. And so we are sure that the pronunciation of Amharic names will not be precise and exact. So let this be a warning to the listener. And to continue, we make mention that we are not professional readers. As a matter of fact, we did not begin to read up until the age of possibly 25, and we are now 30, and that is because we were called to Rastafari. We were called to Christ in light of Rastafari. Until that time, we had no interest in reading. To add to this, we learned to speak and speak mostly Spanish our whole lives to this very day. Therefore, you know, if ones could do it better, by all means, bring it forth. And I just do what we can, and that is to do what we must. The autobiography of Emperor Haile Selassie I, King of Kings of all Ethiopia, and Lord of all Lords, My Life and Ethiopia's Progress, 1892-1937, Haile Selassie I, King of Kings of Ethiopia, Frontline Distribution, International, Incorporated, Chicago, Jamaica, London, Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. Translated and annotated by Edward Uhlendorf, Professor of Ethiopian Studies in the University of London, Volume 1. Translated from the Amharic original, My Life and Ethiopia's Progress. Oppression is, in the Abyssinian dominions, neither frequent nor tolerated, but no form of government has been yet discovered by which cruelty can be wholly prevented. Subordination supposes power on one part and subjection on the other, and if power be in the hands of men, it will sometimes be abused. The vigilance of the supreme magistrate may do much, but much will still remain undone. He can never know all the crimes that are committed, and can seldom punish all that he knows. Chapter 8 of Dr. Johnson's Rasselas, Prince of Abyssinia. Monday, May 29th, 2017. Translator's Preface. A lecture which I had the privilege to deliver at the Accademia Nacional de Lanzi at Rome, at the invitation of its illustrious president Enrico Cerulli, is reprinted here and may serve as an introduction to the present volume. It was read at Easter 1974, but in the light of recent events, it is relevant to observe that it was written at Christmas 1973. In that introduction, I have endeavored to explain and to justify the literalness of my translation, partly in an attempt to maintain or even to mirror the flavor of the original, partly to aid those future historians of the reign of Haile Selassie who have little or no Amharic and to whom this raw rendering may be of greater service than a polished version, partly to offer a crib to students struggling with the original, and finally, to expose my translation to the critical eye of colleagues who will be able to detect where I have gone wrong or misunderstood the original. None of these purposes could have been achieved with a more fluent and literary rendering, which would have blurred the problems and would have taken us even further away from the synthetical intricacies, at times truly remarkable, of the Amharic text. I am profoundly conscious of the stylistic flaws and general ungainliness of the resultant work, but it does at any rate attain a high measure of faithfulness to the original. It would have required translators of the genius of those of the authorized version of the Bible to establish a fair balance between original and version. I have experimented with a translation that might be less graceless than mine, but each attempt has foundered on the horrific abyss and chasm in feeling and performance, that recent prototype from copy or imitative mold. Some sentences, not many, in the original, even though their general purport may be clear, simply do not construe in any conventional sense, and in most of these cases such anacalutha are allowed to peter out equally aimlessly in the translation. I also feel apologetic, though much less so here, about the transcription employed. It seemed to me highly incongruous to have recourse to the full inventory of diacritics and thus press into service an intricate apparatus that would satisfy scientific criteria but would be ill adapted for the audience to which this book is addressed. I have therefore avoided all fuzziness and used forms that will, I trust, be readily intelligible to the English-speaking reader. There are inconsistencies, some, though by no means all, arising from the variant modes of spelling employed in different sources. I should emphasize that the footnotes are of an explanatory and informative character only. They seek to throw light on obscurities and to provide factual background. They deal with matters of substance only and are not intended to be critical or to offer comments on views, events, omissions, or manner of treatment. A name of geographical location is usually annotated at its first occurrence only. The index will mark the principal locus by use of a different font. I have not been able to explain a few of the less well-known names. The emperor had promised me help in the hour of need, but recent events have unhappily rendered this promise incapable of fulfillment. I have, however, been fortunate in being able to call on the wide knowledge of Ethiopian personalities and places posed by His Imperial Highness, the Crown Prince of Ethiopia. I am also grateful to Prince Zara Yaakob and Dr. Zewde Gebreselassie. I have used the conventional terms empire and imperial to render Negus Negesht, though I clearly realize that they bear a connotation in the Western context which the Ethiopic original does not possess. In the introduction, I have referred to the tedium of some speeches and certain documents. All these have been translated from the emperor's Amharic text, mainly to show what interpretation was placed on them by Ethiopians. I have not used the originals of speeches by King George V or King Victor Emmanuel, etc., even if the resultant version must at times seem more than a little quaint. Where differences of substance are involved, I have briefly commented on these in the annotation. Unfortunately, there is very little in this book about the emperor's happy family life, but we are given some fresh insights into the relations with his father, Empress Taitu, Lich Yasu, Empress Zauditu, and many other personalities. His description of the Italian war and of his decision to go abroad also contains aspects and details not hitherto published. The second volume of his autobiography was published in June 1974 and takes us from 1936-37 up to the liberation of Ethiopia in 1941. In the likely absence of a sequel, it is not my intention to translate the second volume, which deals with matters that in one form or another are fairly well documented already. In reading this autobiography, one has to bear in mind constantly that it was written in 1936-37, though not published until 1972-73, which is not only more than a generation ago, but in a world that was totally different in its political and emotional texture from the last quarter of the 20th century in which it appears in print. Moreover, Emperor Haile Selassie, with all his enlightened views, cannot help being a product of Menelik's polity into which he was born and in which he grew up. The intricate system of human relations in the tightly structured and hierarchically integrated Ethiopian society maintains a rigorous hold on all those caught within it. And despite its many shortcomings, who would be so bold as to assert that that system, which its certitudes and carefully distributed responsibilities and restraints, is inferior to the society in which we live with its dissolution of values and of checks and balances? For two-thirds of his life, all the problems Haile Selassie had to face arose from the fact that he was in advance of his time. And it was the tragedy of his reign that during the last third, the wind of change in Africa blew so fiercely and so suddenly that it swept away the good with the evil. It will be clear to the reader that much that is related in this volume, and particularly in the first half, though it occurred only some 70 years ago, could equally well have happened centuries earlier. These are considerations which everyone will have to bear in mind who wishes to make a fair and balanced assessment of this king who dominated Ethiopia's destiny throughout the 20th century. And although these lines are penned while he is still alive, it may already be said of him, seeing his dignity and pride in this hour of turmoil, that nothing in a long reign of achievement as well as vicissitude became him so well like the manner of his leaving it. Finally, I ought to explain how I came to tackle this translation. In January 1973, Princess Herut Desta, the Emperor's granddaughter, came to me and asked me, on behalf of His Majesty, to undertake this work. My first reaction was not favorable, but when, a few weeks later, I had to review this book and got immersed in its intricacies, linguistic and otherwise, I changed my mind. Not least, perhaps, because I thought that translation on this scale might do some good to my Amharic. I subsequently saw His Majesty on two occasions in London. At first, the idea of an annotated translation did not appeal to him, but he was fully convinced of the need for this procedure when last I was received by him at Addis Ababa on 19th March 1974. Since then, I have lived with this biographical study, and so has my wife. Through the vicissitudes of the last year and the agonies endured by the emperor and his people. At times, when I worked on the chapters dealing with the Italian war and the exile following it, I felt a deja vu quality about it all, and never more so than when I read this passage in the second volume, page 72. Our life at Bath was very hard. We also encountered great financial difficulties. Some sources of information had spread the rumor that we had taken a great deal of money with us when leaving the country, and they were attempting to make people believe this, but it is a complete lie. Plus, CA change. Plus, c'est la même chose. Plus, change. Plus, c'est la même chose. It is not for me to say what mistakes of policy the emperor or his government may or may not have made, nor indeed am I qualified to anticipate the verdict of history, in the shaping of which the present volume may play its modest part. I have admired Emperor Haile Selassie for 40 years, from a distance as well as close quarters, and I may thus be forgiven if I am emotionally incapable of joining the rats which are now forsaking the proud ship as it threatens to founder. Easter 1975, Edward Ullendorf. Postscript. Since this preface was written more than 6 months ago, the death of Emperor Haile Selassie occurred on 27th August 1975, while he was denied a proper burial by those who now rule Ethiopia, and the place of his internment remains unknown. The serious organs of the world press have published obituaries of a depth and size not previously accorded to any other African leader. A memorial, evensong, and presentation of garter banner, attended by his son and heir, and an impressive congregation took place at St. George's Windsor Castle, and a memorial tribute was offered by the Earl of Avon. Thus a life has ended of which, like Moses in Deuteronomy 34, no man knoweth of his sepulchre to this day. And until his last days, his eye was not dim, nor his natural force abated. Those of us who really knew the man and the king will long mourn the passing of Haile Selassie, for there will not arise in Ethiopia anyone quite in his image. November 1975. Acknowledgements. I wish to record my gratitude to the Publications Fund of the School of Oriental and African Studies for including this volume in the series of books published for the school by Oxford University Press and for sponsoring its publication. Mr. Martin Daly, the Secretary of Publications Committee, has at all times assisted me with his expert counsel. The bulk of the typing was carried out by Ms. Helena Roth, Ms. Carolyn Beckingham, and by my wife. I am greatly obliged to all three of them for the care they have lavished on the preparation of the typescript. My wife, as usual, has made herself responsible for the compilation of the index and of all the ancillary material. She has also removed many inconsistencies and solecisms. Those which remain have to be laid at my door. Translator Introduction. Whatever the future of Africa in general and Ethiopia in particular may hold, the place of Emperor Haile Selassie in the twilight period of emerging Africa is assured. I do not mean to imply that there will be no argument about the nature of this place, that the verdict of history, whatever this may mean, will be unequivocal, or that even now there are not some among the young urban intelligentsia in Ethiopia who would echo Cromwell's imperious words to the Long Parliament, used so effectively in 1940 by Leopold Amory in relation to Chamberlain. You have sat too long here for any good you have been doing. Depart, I say, and let us have done with you. In the name of God, go. But such cries of impatience are not likely to be confirmed by the calm view of a longer perspective, and the appearance of an imperial autobiography is certainly a singular and most noteworthy phenomenon in Ethiopia, as well as a literary event of some moment. For close on 58 years, Haile Selassie has been ruler of Ethiopia, and for 44 years her emperor, the world's senior statesman, aloof and regal, heir to a long tradition of Semitic exclusiveness, yes, founder of the Organization of African Unity, approachable as well as withdrawn, imbued with profound mystique, small in physical stature, yet commanding in personality and a symbol of regal strength and enduring power. During the lifetime of this emperor, greater and more profound changes have occurred in Ethiopia than throughout the previous 2.5 millennia of recorded Ethiopian history. With his roots firmly embedded in Menelik's quasi-medieval polity and his since concomitant with the antics of General Amin and Colonel Gaddafi, it is scarcely surprising that Haile Selassie is now more than a little out of step with his country's impatient and clamorous youth. What is much more astonishing is the continuing firmness of his grip. At the age of nearly 82, which despite many changes and upheavals, has not been markedly relaxed. The first volume of the Emperor's autobiography, under the title of Hewitenya ye Ethiopia Arimja, i.e., My Life and Ethiopia's Progress, was published in Amharic at Addis Ababa in 1965, Ethiopian era, i.e., early in 1973. It was printed by the Berhan Salam Press in a form which is austere rather than ostentatious, and an edition which is not without external flaws. There are 264 pages, plus 9 unnumbered pages of ancillary material, such as prefaced, list of contents, etc. The book is stated to have been written at Bath in England, where the emperor lived from 1937 to 1940. In Yekatit 1929, February 1937, no names of helpers or secretaries are indicated, except for a mention on page 264 of Blatangeta Mahtama Selassie, who is credited with the preparation of the useful, intricate, yet ingeniously arranged genealogy which traces in a vast circular scheme most of the descendants of King Sehele Selassie of Showa, the present emperor's great-grandfather. The genealogy is in itself a contribution of some importance. The same is true of the photographs, nearly 50 of them, taking us from the extremely attractive child Teferi by way of the commanding figure of the regent to the grave and truly charismatic emperor addressing the League of Nations in 1936. They represent a record of considerable interest. The inclusion of several pictures showing Ijeyasu, Emperor Menelik's grandson and uncrowned successor, who in 1916 was deposed by the author of the present autobiography, is not without interest. In Ethiopia, the book sells for 12 ETH dollars, equals approximately 2.25 or Italian lire 3.300, and it is said that the first impression was sold out within a few days. The present work is expressly described as the first volume, but there is no indication whether further installments will be issued within the foreseeable future. I understand, however, that a second volume is about to be delivered to the press, and that a third part is at present under contemplation by the highest quarter. The first volume, now in our hands, takes us from the birth and childhood of Teferi to the famous and poignant speech to the League of Nations 44 years later. It is likely that the bulk of the book was dedicated by the emperor during his sojourn at Bath, and it is thought that the first redactor was Blatengeta Herui Wolde Selassie, the former foreign minister who died in England in 1938. It is not clear what happened to the manuscript between 1937 and 1972, and there is no express indication whether any changes were introduced in the interval. I have it, however, on fairly good authority, though falling short of certainty, that the tone of the narrative has been softened at many points, particularly in relation to internal events and personalities. Kings and statesmen still in harness will inevitably write with a great deal of reticence and circumspection, and their autobiographies are unlikely to produce any major revelations, nor are the perspectives of 1936 or 7 identical, or even remotely comparable with those of 1972-73. Essentially, a work of this kind is bound to be in the nature of an apologia pro vita sua, and the present book is no exception. Many readers will be tempted to read between the lines, and while Ethiopians will liberally indulge in this pursuit, Western students of Ethiopia will find it hard enough to read the actual Amharic lines without delving into the arcana of interlinear conjectures. Yet it is clearly as important to assess what has been changed or omitted as it is to appreciate what has been included. The emperor was as skilled in those desperate days, more than 35 years ago, as he is now in expressing himself with a lofty disdain for specifics and with all the oracular trappings of a papal pronouncement. In his inimitable style and elevated diction, he is used to telling us what he wishes to convey rather than what importunate foreigners might like to hear. In these aims, he is assisted by the full resources of Amharic stylistics, which are as apt to aid and abet a desire for almost total opacity as they may illumine complicated thought process by their marvelous flexibility and clarity and hierarchical structuring. The emperor's life between 1892 and 1936, as described in the book, falls broadly into three main periods: his youth and the assumption of ever more important functions of state, the regency and foreign travel, as well as relations with the West, the assumption of the crown in 1930, and the growing danger of war leading to the events of 1935-36. The 50 chapters are arranged in roughly chronological sequence under headings such as the story of my childhood up to my appointment as Dejasmach, or from my appointment as Dejasmach to the death of my father, etc. Other chapters, also within the general chronological setting, deal with one specific event only, e.g., Ethiopia's entry into the League of Nations, chapter 13, or the Anglo-Italian Agreement of December 1925 relating to Lake Tana and the projected railway from Eritrea to Italian Somaliland, chapter 22, etc. I notice, incidentally, that in rendering the heading as Ethiopia's entry into the League of Nations, I have introduced a subtle deviation from the Amharic original, which refers to Andetegaba Sela Madregachen, i.e. our, the royal plural, causing Ethiopia to enter. The emperor is the actor and motivator throughout. There is no deed or action in his realm without his initiative. The basically analytic arrangement may seem somewhat constrictive to the Western reader, yet the total effect, especially in the earlier chapters, is, in fact, rather vivid. It must, however, be conceded that this is true only of the Amharic original. No translation can do justice to the peculiar flavor of the Amharic stylistic genre. The most touching aspect of Haile Selassie's childhood is his close relationship with his father, Ras Makonnen, which is beautifully described. The assumption of ever-increasing responsibilities by the boy of 13 shows the traditional Ethiopian system at its best, a closely knit society with functions, obligations, and rights, noblesse oblige, in the truest sense of the word, which devolve quite naturally upon those who have been brought up within this clearly defined hierarchical framework. A particularly fascinating chapter deals with the developing conflict between Ligiasu and Teferi, the former's disposition, and the beginning of the regency with all the strains and stresses between the exponents and the rigidly traditional order, symbolized by the Empress Zauditu, and the new ideas, however cautiously expressed, by the youthful Ras Teferi. I have said that an imperial autobiography is a singular and memorable event in Ethiopian history. True, royal chronicles have long formed part of Ethiopic literature, and the biographical genre is by no means unknown in Ethiopia. The Gedle, originally struggle, is the type of life and acts of saints and martyrs so ubiquitous in Ethiopian literary history. But such chronicles and acts are essentially annals, which are mostly closer to the hagiographical species than to Western conceptions of historiography. Some of these chronicles and Gedle are indeed of great significance, and scholars like Conti, Rossini, and Cerulli, and most recently Tadasse Tamrat, have derived a good deal of religious, social, and political history from them. One need only think of the splendid narrative of the victories of the 14th century warrior king Amdaseyon. Some Ethiopian emperors are even said to have been authors of theological tracts, such as the 15th century reformer king Zara Yaikob, to whom various books, notably the Mashafa Berhan Book of Light, Mitzhafe Berhan, Book of Light, so well edited by Conti, Rossini, and Ricci, are attributed. European missionaries and travelers have left us biographical sketches of various emperors, none more vivid or imaginative than the portraits of the royal personages of his day drawn by the great Scots explorer James Bruce. Since 1855, Ethiopia has, in effect, had only four emperors, leaving aside the two brief interregna associated with the names of Wagshum Gobaye, 1868-72, and Ligiasu, 1913-1916, and each of these has been the subject of biographical studies of varying importance, though none till Haile Selassie has essayed the autobiographical genre. The Emperor Theodore Tewodros, 1855-1868, apart from numerous European studies chiefly associated with the Napier expedition of 1867 and 68, has been the subject of three useful Ethiopian biographies, not to mention some more recent plays. Even though these are rather brief and somewhat incomplete, they were edited by E. Littman, C. Mandan Vidalhit, and L. Fusela, respectively. And in 1973 alone, there appeared at least two English novels of King Theodore, The Hammer of God by Ellen Schofield, and The Guns of Darkness by Anne Skelly. The Tigrayan Emperor Johannes VI, 1872-1889, had received rather summary treatment by Western and indigenous writers. This applies even to Heruy Amharic's Opuscu, Ethiopia and Metemma, A Short History of Emperor Johannes, 17 pp, Addis Ababa, 1917-1918, until his great-great-grandson Digismach Zeo de Gebreselassie produced a fine Oxford doctoral thesis devoted to the reign of his ancestor, now in the press. Menelik II, 1889-1913, has fared rather better, both in European and Ethiopian accounts, but especially in the annals by his minister of the pen, Gebreselassie, published in French in 1930-1932 and in Amharic in 1966-67. Menelik's daughter Zauditu, Empress 1916-1930, was a sovereign in name only and was completely overshadowed by her regent and successor Rastaferri. Nevertheless, a biographical study of Zauditu would not be without interest. Haile Selassie I, regent from 1916-1930, emperor since 1930, has not been uniformly fortunate in the innumerable accounts of his life and deeds. Of the more substantial ones, the books by Christine Sandford and Leonard Mosley deserve mention. The present volume of the autobiography draws on the emperor's recollections, but the meticulous details as regards dates, often even including days of the week, which are nearly always accurate, itineraries, etc., shows that the narrative must have been buttressed by recourse to archival material. Whether this material accompanied the emperor into exile, as seems likely, or was subsequently added by his amanuensis, I am unable to say. The precise nature and condition of the imperial archives are, in any event, not generally known. The narrative is interspersed with many documents. These are particularly valuable when we are offered Amharic originals, often for the first time. They are much less interesting, at any rate for the Western reader, where we have translations into Amharic not invariably accurate from European sources such as treaties, documents of state, or merely address of welcome. These latter have a certain tedium in their inevitably repetitive character. I have been given to understand that a rough translation into English has been in existence for quite a number of years. I also gather that this translation is currently being revised and improved with a view to early publication. Insofar as my views have been sought, I have made it clear, both to His Imperial Majesty himself and to his advisors, that only an annotated translation would make sense in terms of comprehending the nature of this work as well as with respect to successful marketing. I am not sure that this view has found favor in the eyes of those in charge of the project. In the meantime, I have carried on with my own annotated translation, which now covers well over one half of the book, including annotation. I should explain what I mean by annotation. Here I refer not only to an explanation of the general background, such as Ethiopian customs mentioned in the text, personal and geographical names, etc., but also to historical and linguistic explanations, such as corroborations from other sources, or elucidation of complex textual problems. Moreover, in quite a few cases, the identification of personal names is distinctly difficult. In a few instances, European geographical locations appear to corrupt the Amharic original. At times, dates cannot be correct as they stand, and errors of many different kinds have crept into the Amharic version. Then, there are quite a number of cases where original Amharic documents were misconstrued in the existing Western rendering, or vice versa, and such discrepancies deserve to be pointed out in footnotes. Some of these divergences are of considerable historical or other interest. Let me now give you a few examples of what I have in mind. Some of the most sensitive writings occurs in the early parts of the book, where, as I have indicated, the relationship of the boy Teferi to his father is described. One passage must suffice to exemplify this. Because my father was on his own after his wife, my mother, Waizero Yashemabet, had died, he used to neglect his meal times and let them pass. But as there was nobody who would dare to say, "Your Highness, mealtime has arrived," I would beg him in fear, entering his chamber and saying, "Mealtime has come, so please let it be your wish for dinner to be brought in." And consequently, he and the officers would order the meal to be brought in at once with a view to pleasing me. When I saw him eat, I felt a sense of joyful pride in my youthful spirit, and my father used to commend me for doing this. Page 21. A dramatic and indeed tragic incident it described effectively, perhaps because of what would now be termed its low-key narrative. When Dejasmach Teferi was involved in a boating accident on Lake Haramaya, halfway between Harar and Diredawa, and 7 of the 10 men in the boat were drowned, page 42, the writing is devised throughout to point the moral, i.e., that Providence had spared Teferi, as he had been chosen for a higher destiny. The names of his companions involved in this accident are set out in the book, but here and elsewhere I have not yet, owing to my ignorance, been able to identify every person. I am still hopeful that I shall succeed, at any rate in the great majority of cases, before my translation is published. While on the subject of unidentified names, I should mention that a few of the locations described in the course of the Regent's 1924 tour of Europe have so far defeated me. Thus, I do not know where on the outskirts of Paris the Villa Camastera, page 92, is which Rastaferi rented during his sojourn in the French capital. Neither contemporary French newspapers nor colleagues who were in Paris at the operative time have so far been able to throw any light on the identity of spelling of that name. Similar considerations apply to the Belgian city of Morage, page 95, which the Regent visited during the same period, or the seaside palace of the King of Sweden called Tolgan, page 97. Among names which I have been able to identify, although at times somewhat disguised, are Admiral Kondratiotis, the then president of the Greek Republic, page 83, and M. Sophilis, not Sophalis, a printing mistake which every Ethiopian peasant can easily spot, page 115. The Greek Prime Minister, Sir Ronald Graham, the British ambassador to Rome, appears oddly enough as Sir Roland, page 126, and the Secretary General of the League of Nations was, of course, not de Remond, page 137, but Sir Eric Drummond. Those in charge of the final editing of this imperial work were occasionally a little careless. Let me turn to some quite different topics. We are told, page 21, how Ras Makonnen assigned to his son Teferi a separate establishment shortly after his appointment to the rank of Dejasmach at the age of 12 or 13. At that time, a German mission under Dr. Frederick Rosen visited Ethiopia and also stayed at Harar. While there, Ras Makonnen asked members of the expedition to visit his son Teferi, which they did in January 1905, when the young prince was 12 and a half years old. The account of their visit to Teferi is highly significant, for it shows that the boy of 12 exhibited then the same dignity, composure, and aloofness which the world has come to expect of the aged emperor. Court etiquette was formal and strict. Lichtavri is slender and delicate. His features are genuinely Semitic, and his color is fairly light. Both are marks of noble blood in Ethiopia. His demeanor was composed and dignified, and conversation was confined to the exchange of courtesies and compliments. It was conducted in Amharic at the prince's request, although his French is said to be quite good. He accepted our presence with gracious thanks, but betrayed no outward sign of pleasure, for such manifestations are confined to ordinary people. His questions about arms and equipments showed interest as well as understanding. When I tried to take photographs, the prince asked me to desist, as he had received no instructions from his father on this subject. Felix Rosen, Eine Deutsche Gesandtschaft in Abyssinien, Leipzig, 1907, 1983-84. While this passage offers interesting and independent corroboration of what appears in the autobiography, the need for annotation for the benefit of non-Ethiopian readers is clearly demonstrated at many points. Thus, we are told that Ras Makonnen married in about 1876 Wayzero Yashemabet, the future emperor's mother, as his lawful wife at a church ceremony. Pages 14 and 25. In the first place, it is necessary to know something about Ethiopian marriage customs, or at least to be given bibliographical references to the different types of marriage practiced in Ethiopia. Secondly, Ras Makonnen had been married previously, and his common-law wife, this at any rate appears to have been her status, it was scarcely a Alkidan Bakverban marriage, i.e. one sanctified in church by joint communion, is not specifically named, page 25. In any event, she is the woman who had given birth to Teferi's elder half-brother, Dejismach Yilma. The latter was born in 1877. He was thus 15 years older than Teferi and died in 1907 at the age of 30. It would appear, therefore, that the dates in the book are not wholly reliable. It seems unlikely, in particular, that the marriage to Wayzero Yeshemabet took place as early as 1876, page 14. If Dejismach Yelma, who subsequently married Wayzero Asalafaj, the niece of Empress Taitu, was born in 1877. I must say a few words on language and style. His Imperial Majesty's predilections in the stylistic field are, of course, well known from published speeches, admonitions to his people, prefaces to books, etc. The present work contains no surprises, and I have already alluded to the felicities of praising, particularly where delicate political matters are involved, as well as to a certain repetitiveness, probably unavoidable in the case of formal address of welcome and other occasions of this character. When last I had the honor to read a paper at this famous academy during the Fourth Congress of Ethiopian Studies in 1972, I spoke on animistic expressions and other aspects of direct speech in Amharic, cf. The Congress Report and also BSOAS 1972-270. I have found at least two further examples of the constructions I had in mind in the Imperial Autobiography. They are particularly beautiful specimens. Yelchegut shera mesheratachu albeka beloachu. 33:25. Literally, his doing childish deeds said to him, I have not enough yet. This passage occurs in a message of complaint about Lijiyasu, addressed to his father, and means, of course, that Lijiyasu wanted to continue with his perilia. See page 52 below. The other example, that of an elliptical conditional clause, is attributed to Negus Mikael. Le Islam Negus Kaltegezachu, 35:10. Unless you submit to a Muslim king, were the apodices of this uncompleted conditional clause must be envisaged in terms of you will be damned or words to this effect. Again, there are other instances where the text appears to be faulty and where sentences just will not construe. A case in point is at 104, 1 to 3, where a number of accusatives seems to be suspended in the air without a governing verb. Here it would seem that the insertion of bemikotatar after nienj will remedy the position. The editors ought not to have allowed this to pass, and no list of errata is appended to the volume. Language criteria also throw an interesting light on the official relationship between Empress Zawditu and the regent, Rastafari. When the queen writes or speaks to him, she uses the appellation Lij, my son, and the second person singular pronoun Ante, thou or tu, pages 98 and 99, while Rastafari refers to her as Germawit, majesty, or Negesht, queen. And these nouns are always accompanied by the third-person plural or polite suffixes attached to verbs or nouns. It is incidentally interesting to note that when the empress replies to the regent's speeches or addresses, her own pronouncements are read for her by the Sahafi Te'izaz, the so-called minister of the pen, 99, 28, and 9. She does not speak herself. Throughout the book, personal and hierarchical relationships are subtly elucidated by the device of using either second person singular or third person plural and polite forms. When Empress Zawditu speaks or writes, she refers to herself in the first person singular, and so does the regent when he communicates with his sovereign. Otherwise, Tefri does not initiate the royal plural, only with his ascension to the throne in 1930. But the pluralis majestatis already appears predominantly, if not consistently, ever since his elevation to the dignity of Ras, regent, heir of the throne, and Leulnat, highness, in 1916. I should explain, apropos of problems connected with language and translation, that throughout my rendering of this autobiography, I have endeavored to do justice to the original. Not, of course, by trying to imitate the shape of Amharic syntax, but by using a similar level of speech. There is a certain awkwardness in the flow of the English translation, which is intended to mark it unequivocally as a translation in its archaizing tendencies, in its involved sentences, and in its faithfulness to the feel of the Amharic original. I am not, of course, claiming that I have succeeded in this. I am simply stating my aims. Anyone who has ever tried his hand at translating the highly involved, not to say convoluted, structure of Amharic sentences into a European language will be conscious of the extreme complexity of such an undertaking. It would, of course, be fairly easy to cut up long Amharic periods with their highly charged logical subordinations and carefully and intricately dovetailed hierarchical structures and convert them into short and idiomatic English or French or Italian sentences which no longer betray their provenance and origin. There are indeed contexts where such a procedure would be entirely appropriate, but I did not feel that in the case of the present work it was proper to present a translation wholly severed from its indigenous ambience. While it is impossible to imitate Amharic syntax, it appeared feasible and indeed desirable to stay close to the sinews and tendons which hold together the framework of an Amharic sentence. I had meant to give you a few examples of what I have in mind, but I found that such a procedure was not really practicable. Not only would it have occupied all the time allotted to me, but above all, it would have required a large blackboard on which to write. In three parallel columns, the Amharic original, my Amharic-based rendering, and a wholly free translation. I must, therefore, confine myself to describing the aims of my translation in one sentence, to be as faithful as possible and as free as is absolutely necessary to reflect the original as transparently as can be achieved with the tools of a totally different language, and not to disguise the awkwardness and hesitation of the source by a rendering that is facile and smooth. There is just one brief illustration I would like to add to this. In the sample passage, which I have adduced earlier on, I have intentionally left the direct speech elements of the original Amharic, as there was nobody who would dare to say, "Your Highness, mealtime has arrived." I would beg him in fear, entering his chamber and saying, "Mealtime has come. So please, let it be your wish for dinner to be brought in." It would have been very easy to render this into more normal English and cut out the awkwardness of the direct quotation, such as there was nobody who would dare remind my father of his mealtimes, I would enter his chamber somewhat hesitantly and suggest to him that he should order dinner. I think, however, that it will be generally agreed that much of the flavor and directness of the original would thus be lost, and it seemed to me preferable throughout to risk some ungainliness, even clumsiness, of English style, if thereby I would achieve a greater awareness of the structure of the Amharic original. In a few instances, I have been able to procure the originals or translations of some passages included in the book, such as treaties, international agreements, or public speeches, and I have been surprised how often the European rendering failed to reflect the Amharic original, or vice versa. And these cases range from the trivial to the crucial clause in a treaty. I have aimed throughout at translating the Amharic text where I had access to a European translation or original, respectively. I have referred to the divergence in the apparatus without allowing this to influence my rendering of the Amharic version. One or two brief examples. In Rastafari's complaint to the League of Nations about the Anglo-Italian Agreement of December 1925, the following passage occurs, which, in my view, means, "It did not seem to us proper to allow some members of the League of Nations to conclude an agreement among themselves and to force another member to accept their plan, even if it did not affect the national interest of that member." 110:22-4. The official English translation of this clause is as follows. "We were not told that certain members of the League might make a separate agreement to impose their views on another member, even if the latter considered those views incompatible with its national interest." CMD 2792, 1927, page 7. Leaving aside for the moment the question of the general faithfulness of this translation, the even clause seems to me rather illogical. It should surely read particularly. It should, however, be mentioned that it was the custom in those days for the Ethiopian government to issue the Amharic text of any note accompanied by a French translation. I imagine the English version is a rendering of the French text, which I have not seen, and I am not therefore in a position to say at what point any discrepancies may have arisen. The opposite process has occurred in a passage where the official Italian version of a letter addressed to Sir Ronald Graham reads, "Il governo britannico riconoscerà anche l'esclusiva dell'influenza economica italiana." Africa Orientale, I-336. The Amharic translation, as it appears in the Emperor's autobiography, can only be understood as the British government, on its part, will then recognize Italy's special economic influence. 107.8. It need hardly be pointed out that the term esclusivita differs a good deal from the Amharic yatalaya, special. No wonder that mistranslations are apt to give rise to international conflicts. Tradottore, tradottere, sometimes even with the best intentions. Incidentally, influence appears in Amharic as Sultan, power. Nowadays, Megababit or Tasino would be more common. I have said earlier on that we possess no clear information about the nature and condition of the imperial archives. Even less do we know which parts of them traveled with His Majesty to Britain between 1936 and 1940. It is therefore impossible to explain any discrepancies between Amharic documents published in the autobiography and versions printed elsewhere. A case in point is the proclamation issued by Dejismach Teferi in July 1913, when he was governor of Harar province. I have dealt with the text of that proclamation as compared with the version collected by J.I.A.D. in Ethiopia in 1913, in a collation published in B.S.O.A.S. 1974. Neither His Imperial Majesty nor the late Major Eddy is informative about the provenance of the text printed in their respective books. The differences between the two versions relate to orthography, punctuation, and textual variants, which range from the trivial to distinctions of substance. These textual variants are reminiscent of aspects of text transmission which we encounter in those parts of the Old Testament that are extant in doublets. It would have been interesting to compare the originals on which the two printed Amharic versions are based. I shall conclude with a few miscellaneous points of general interest. At one stage in the book, the emperor explains that as there existed no railway in those days, as it does today, the journey from Harar to Addis Ababa used to take a month, page 17. The distance between these two cities is some 250 to 300 miles, and we know that it was possible to get a message through in 2 or 3 days. It was also quite feasible to reach one's destination within a week or so. But when the emperor says that it used to take a month, he refers to the kind of progress made by Ras Makonnen, or himself, a great nobleman, was accompanied not only by his retainers, but by a veritable army of hangers-ons. This inevitably slowed progress considerably. Moreover, at every larger place a stopover was de rigueur. Delegations were received, courtesies exchanged, complaints heard, and all the intricate ritual of Ethiopian life and etiquette had to be observed. Later on, the railway came to Dire Dawa, and the distance could be covered in a day. Nowadays, it takes an hour by air, and this is the measure of change that has taken place in Haile Selassie's lifetime, where distances of 1 month have been reduced to 1 hour. Explanations of this type have to be included in the annotation, and this annotation also has to make reference to such oddities as the detachment from the region's entourage of three personages who accompanied him to Europe in the summer of 1924, and their dispatch to Germany to deliver a letter of friendship to President Hindenburg, page 113. But the fact is that in the summer of 1924, at the time of Ras Teferi's tour of Europe, Ebert was president of the German Republic, and Marshal Hindenburg did not succeed him till after Ebert's death in the spring of 1925. It is interesting to observe that the autobiography is exclusively concerned with the life and the activities of its author. There are few reflections or observations of a general kind, and certainly no comment whatever on the events and personages of his era. Thus, Ras Teferi arrived in France in May 1924 in the middle of a major government and indeed constitutional crisis, which early in June led to the resignation not only of Poincaré's government, but even to that of the President of the Republic himself, M. Alexandre Millerand, 1859-1943, had been President of the French Republic since 1920, yet when the regent met him in May 1924, shortly before his withdrawal from the presidency, he is described as the new president, page 90. In fact, when Ras Teferi returned to Paris in August 1924, the new president, M. Gaston Domergue, had taken over, and M. Harriot had become prime minister and foreign minister. It was when that the regent met the truly new president, page 115. Again, the editors who allowed the first reference to the new president, page 90, to pass clearly did not discharge their task with the necessary care. More interesting, however, is the fact that the book has not a single word about the severe crisis which convulsed France when the Ethiopian regent stepped on French soil. His serene aloofness from events and exclusive preoccupation with the minute of etiquette are like an unbroken thread running through the whole course of this work. On this first visit ever to the West by an Ethiopian ruler, there are no thoughts on the nature of Western society or technological progress, nor are there any comparisons with the conditions in which Ethiopia then found herself. The writing is not philosophical, but, as I have indicated, essentially analytic, enumerative, catalog-like. Similarly, while we are given a full list of the princes, noblemen, and officials who accompanied the regent on his European tour, page 84, no further mention is made of any of them in the course of the narrative. We are not told what they thought of their great experience, and whether Jerusalem or Alexandria, Paris or Stockholm, Cambridge or Athens held their attention. We only know from other sources that while Ras Hailu went on a gay tour of the sites and indulged in a vast shopping spree, the Prince Regent visited schools, university, and hospitals. There are no references to Ras Hailu's antics as the infant terrible of the party. Thus, it is said that King George V asked Ras Hailu whether he knew any English or French or Arabic. When he had to answer all these questions in the negative, he, in his turn, asked the British monarch whether he could speak Amharic or Tigrinya or Gala. The reply was a predictable no, whereupon Ras Hailu said to the king, allegedly to the latter's huge enjoyment, "Then, Your Majesty, it would appear that we are both equally ignorant." None of this will be found in Haile Selassie's autobiography. There are no anecdotes. There is no bon mot, no wit. Its purpose is austerely and severely serious, moralistic, and didactic. Haiwatenya ye Ethiopia Arimja, My Life and Ethiopia's Progress, has been issued as a public document and for the official record. Whether there might yet exist a more private and more penetrating record of the emperor's life is not known to me. Meanwhile, we must be grateful for this privileged, if cautious, glimpses into the life of one who would have been adjudged great even if no crown had adorned his head. Preface. A house built on granite and strong foundations, not even the onslaught of pouring rain, gushing torrents, and strong winds will be able to pull down. Some people have written the story of my life, representing as truth what in fact derives from ignorance, error, or envy, but they cannot shake the truth from its place even if they attempt to make others believe it. Where it says some people have written the story of my life, it has a footnote which reads, I am not clear what works available in 1936-1937 the emperor had in mind. It should be recalled that at the time of writing, 36 years before this book appeared in print in Amharic, the emperor was only 44 years of age. At this hour, when I have found occasion and time to write the story of my life, I preface my writing by presenting the following prayer to my Creator and then continue this work. O Lord Almighty, in whom there is no weakness, eternal, in whom there is no transience, in admiring your work as well as your judgments, a created being, even after much searching, cannot fathom them, except to a limited extent. It is a subtle secret which a creature, even after much exploring, cannot know, but which you alone do know. Why, in the immediate past as well as now, you have made the Ethiopian people, from the ordinary man to the emperor, sink in a sea of distress for a time, and why you have made the Italian people, up to its king, swim in a sea of joy for a time. Since no creature created in your image and to your pattern gives up hope that everything he begs of you will be done for him until the day you sever his soul from his body, we beseech you
that Ethiopia should not remain with her freedom extinct and prostrate under an alien ruler, so that the mouth of her peoples be silenced for fear of a foreign governor, but rather that you will save them by your deeds of kindness, lest they remain with their hearts oppressed through being deprived of their own Ethiopian ruler, who was leading them toward civilization under a light yoke and with gladness. O Lord, abode of exiles, light of the blind, truth and justice are your thrones. Receive us, who have been exiled from our freedom's sake, who have had to leave our country on account of violent assault. In praying to you thus, it is not for our righteousness, but for your great mercies. Footnote to your great mercies, that is a reference to the book of the prophet Daniel, chapter 9, verse 18. And now I am setting out contemplating to write the story of my life from my 13th year until this time on the basis of what you have wrought. Making me your instrument, I pray to you that it may be your will to let it reach completion. It is right for me to reveal in this preface the reason why I have thought to write this, although from you nothing is hidden. First, that your name be praised for all the deeds you do, acting according to your wishes. Second, when you make a man rich in the honors of this world and appoint him above other creatures, that it be known that it is not for his merit, but only through your benevolence and generosity. Third, in every line in this history, where the name of another person is mentioned, it is not through partiality or enmity, save an error. But you know that we are making our heart the judge to write only the truth. Fourth, although there is nothing that is not written in the Holy Scriptures, if you will enable me to write as I have planned, may our kin and our brothers who will rise up in future take note of the word you have spoken, for without me you can do nothing. This also includes a footnote, which is a reference to the Gospel of St. John, chapter 15, verse 5. Without Jesus Christus, we can do nothing. He is the vine, and we are his branches. Continuing, it says, and may their hearts be convinced that with your help alone will they be able to do anything. Fifth, unless a man discharges his task by his own resolve and perseverance, conscious of being your tool, whether in times of joy or tribulation, he should realize that he ought to work by his innate ability or by such education as he may have acquired, for his responsibility will not cease even if he acts solely under another man's will. Sixth, whatever the task may be, let everyone realize and be convinced that it will be accomplished at the proper time and age, and that it is impossible to have it fulfilled either by just desiring it or by hurrying it unduly. I pray to you that all this may be in full accord with your will. Preface to the 1997 Research Associates Frontline Edition. The first and principal volume of Emperor Haile Selassie's autobiography, taking us from his birth to his exile in Britain in 1937, thus covering the early and least well-known period of his life, was published in Amharic at Addis Ababa in 1973. At His Majesty's request, I translated and annotated this work into English. It appeared in 1976, published by the Oxford University Press for the School of Oriental and African Studies, London University. Details of its genesis and travails were set out in a series of prefaces and introductions. During the last years of the emperor's life and its immediate aftermath, the hardback edition was reprinted 6 times and sold an unexpectedly large number of copies. The last reprint of 1993 was exhausted a little while ago, with quite a few unfulfilled orders having accumulated since then. At this stage, it was generally felt that a photographic reprint would be the most suitable way of proceeding henceforth. In the meantime, the Oxford University Press has forwarded to me a number of reprints offers they had received. Among these, I selected a proposal by Ras Sekou Teferi of Frontline Distribution International, Incorporated, and subsequent correspondence and signature of the contract have strongly suggested to me that choice will prove to have been a very fortunate one. It now seems that the photographic reprint of the XXXII plus 335 pages of the original work may appear by or before the middle of 1997, when the emperor was deposed in September 1974, and as far as is known now, murdered by Mengistu in August 1975, Ethiopia suffered what has turned out to be the bloodiest and most traumatic 17 years of its long history, with Mengistu's ejection and flight from justice. In 1991, there has been a great measure of amelioration. In the 23 years since Haile Selassie's removal from power, an entire generation of Ethiopians, both inside and outside the country, has grown up without much knowledge, if any, of the last reigning king. That generation, and even their elders, should be reminded of the rich and proud legacy of Ethiopia's progress under Haile Selassie. Whatever problems may have occurred during those 58 years of rule, they will yet be remembered and assessed by future historians against the background of the calamities that were to follow. I am gratified that this new edition of My Life and Ethiopia's Progress, 1892-1937, should see the light of day thanks to the endeavors of a Rastafarian establishment representing people who have done much to keep Haile Selassie's memory alive and have also so devotedly looked after his grandson, Edward Ullendorf, Oxford, February 1997.
Introduction. Whatever the task may be, man may begin it, but he cannot complete it unless God sustains and supports him. If he fails to accomplish the task on which he has set out, having worked to the best of his ability, he is not to be maligned by being called the lazy. Thus we ourselves, by virtue of our descent from the Queen of Sheba and King Solomon, ever since we accepted in trust in 1909-1916, first the regency of the Ethiopian realm and later the imperial dignity, right up to the present, we have set out to the best of our ability to improve, gradually, internal administration by introducing into the country Western modes of civilization through which our people may attain a higher level. Hence, our conscience does not rebuke us. In explanation of the notion gradually, unless it is through coaxing a child and getting it accustomed, it will not be pleased if one takes from it what it has seized with its hand. When one gives such a baby any sort of food, it will not wish to eat it unless one shows it to the child and lets it taste it. Unless they give it milk or other soft food until it grows teeth, it will not be able to eat when they place bread or meat before it. And similarly, with people who have lived by custom only, without learning at school, without absorbing knowledge by the ear and observing and searching with the eye, it is necessary to accustom them, through education, to abandon habits by which they have for long been living, to make them accept new ways, yet not by hasty or cruel methods, but by patience and study, gradually and over a prolonged period. In 1908-1909, Emperor Menelik fell ill and had to spend his time at home. Soon after this, Ras Bitwadad Tatsama, Lijiasu's regent, suddenly died. As a consequence, Lijiasu, who had accepted the authority to guide the government, was for about 6 years quite incapable of shouldering his responsibility. When I myself overtook this responsibility in 1909-1916, it was necessary to correct the chaotic neglect of fully 6 years and to make a beginning with the work not yet started, i.e., of introducing the new civilization. I spent my time working to the best of my ability, while my own ideas and the people, fond of the old customs, particularly as the latter had many supporters, squeezed me like wood between two pieces of iron. There was very little time that I could spend in idle conversations and doing the things that give one pleasure. What I set right in terms of internal administration initiated already at an earlier stage the innovations I brought about and such aspects of foreign-inspired civilization as I introduced into the country will be found in the following, each at its proper place. In addition to this, from time to time, we encountered some difficulties, internal as well as external, which were spread about by natives or by foreigners, and which constituted obstacles to our work of innovation. It was thus essential to carry out everything patiently. In order to prevent upheavals, bloodshed, and tribal divisions, I was aware, even before I took over the affairs of government, that internal upheaval constituted a useful contribution to the designs of our enemies. We were particularly convinced by the policies directed against us that the enemy's heart was stricken with envy at our setting up a constitution to strengthen and to consolidate Ethiopia's unity, at our opening schools for boys and girls, at our building hospitals in which our people's health was to be safeguarded, as well as at all sorts of other initiatives of ours by which Ethiopia's independence would be affirmed, not only in terms of history, but in actual fact. For this reason, while we took great care to prevent any divisions among our people, we did not wish to take any coercive measures that might appear oppressive to our people. While we engaged upon all this careful work and were beginning to lead our people on the road to civilization, our enemy rose up with violence, sending to our country many troops with modern equipment, as well as numerous warplanes and tanks, breaking the covenant of the nations and fighting us with machine guns and artillery, and with modern weapons many times superior in quality and quantity to our equipment. We addressed an appeal to the League of Nations, and with our heart free of panic, we encouraged our armies. While we resisted firmly and defended ourselves, they poured all sorts of poison and smoke gases upon us, which were capable of causing serious damage and which are prohibited by international law. They dropped many bombs on us and even bombarded the International Red Cross doctors together with their medical equipment, thus preventing those injured by bombs and machine guns or suffocating with poison gas from receiving medicine, attention, or cure. We ourselves fought for our liberty in battles like any ordinary soldier and mustered the troops like any other officer. On account of our inability to obtain even a loan for the purchase of arms, we did not have any adequate equipment for defense, except for a few modern weapons. After we had resisted to the best of our ability with weapons 40 years old, we were defeated for the time being in no shameful manner. The reason why we returned to Addis Ababa and why we departed from Addis Ababa to go abroad and all other such matters are to be found in the following at their appropriate place. We would therefore remind confidently and earnestly all those who are Ethiopian subjects to persist unceasingly by striving to the best of their ability in the study of Ethiopia's past from the earliest phases of history, lest her freedom be extinguished altogether in the future, particularly as our country of Ethiopia has now been overwhelmed by perils which give rise to anxiety for her independence. We would equally urge all those who are not Ethiopians, but who hate aggression and love truth and justice, not to withhold their support for the cause of Ethiopia's liberty, the people at large by their counsel, and the priest by their prayer. Bath, England, written Yekatit 1929, that's to say February 19, 37, Haile Selassie I, Emperor of Ethiopia.